Hi, it's Michelle from Lab Muffin Beauty Science here, chemistry PhD skincare nerd and someone who really likes foaming cleansers. There are a lot of myths about foaming cleansers and the ingredients in foaming cleansers and how to use foaming cleansers, so today I'm going to be busting some of these myths. I asked you all to send me cleanser myths in my Instagram stories and I got so many replies, thank you so much. It was actually really helpful because there were so many myths that I already had in mind, but also so many that I just forgot about. A word of warning before we begin, the answer to a lot of these is going to be it depends. It won't be a simple yes or no. I know it isn't as satisfying and a lot of us just want certainty, but unfortunately a lot of stuff in skincare is quite complex. A lot of the time the research hasn't really come to a firm conclusion yet, and a lot of myths do have a little bit of truth to them. I also talk more about cleansing and all the other important steps in a skincare routine in my ebook, The Lab Muffin Guide to Basic Skincare, so check that out if you want more info. The first myth is, are foaming cleansers always bad for your skin? Are foaming cleansers harsher than other cleansers? This used to be true. Back in the day with older cleansers, the only ingredient that was commonly used to make lots of foam was sodium lauryl sulfate. A bit of background on cleansing ingredients. Cleansing ingredients are called surfactants. They have this sort of structure. They have a head that likes water and a tail that likes oil. The two together in the one package means that surfactants can help oil lift off skin and surfaces and disperse into water, so you can actually rinse it off. Sodium lauryl sulfate is a surfactant and it happens to be quite skinny for a surfactant. That means it can penetrate into skin more easily and stay there, and that's what leads to irritation and that tight feeling you sometimes get after you wash off a cleanser. But with newer cleansers, firstly, there are lots more ways to produce lots of foam, and secondly, there are ways to formulate with sodium lauryl sulfate that stops it from being quite as irritating. First, let's talk about foam. Products that foam a lot don't necessarily clean better, and they don't necessarily irritate more. The three can correlate, but they don't always. It's like owning cats versus happiness versus spending a lot of money. The three are sort of linked, but not really. So foam, cleansing, and irritation, they all have a lot to do with surfactants. But foam making is to do with how well a surfactant stabilizes a liquid film that is trapping air. Cleansing ability is to do with how well surfactants pull oil and dirt off skin. Now, you might have thought that cleansing too well, cleansing too much stuff off your skin, is also what causes irritation. And scientists thought this for a really long time. But it turns out that's not the main reason for irritation. The main part of irritation is actually how well a surfactant burrows into skin and stays there and disrupts your skin barrier. With foam, there are now lots of surfactants that can foam really well without being as irritating as SLS. Leucocytes, betaines, sultanes, ether sulfates, sarcosinates, taurates, isoethionates are all very good at foaming. There are also lots of non-surfactant ingredients that are really good at stabilizing foam. And these don't necessarily add to irritation, so these are things like glycerin and thickeners. Foaming pump tops are also getting more popular, so even if a cleanser doesn't foam well when you just rub it on your hands, the packaging can increase the foam. There are also lots of ingredients that can be added to cleansers to make them less irritating, and this is a lot more common now. For example, it turns out that adding emollients, which are moisturizing ingredients, to a foaming cleanser can make it less irritating than a non-foaming cleanser without these added ingredients. In this study, over 5 days, the non-foaming cleanser actually dried out skin, while the foaming cleanser with these added emollients actually increased skin hydration over the 5 days. So yeah, modern foaming cleansers can be very, very gentle. That actually ticks off another myth I got asked, which is, can cleansers actually hydrate and moisturize skin? And this study seems to say, yes, some can. And this makes sense because cleansers can actually deliver active ingredients, which I'm going to talk about a little bit later, but first I wanted to talk about sulfates. Are sodium lauryl sulfate and sodium lauryl sulfate as bad as everyone makes them out to be? Again, historically, sodium lauryl sulfate was quite harsh, but in modern cleansers, there are lots of ways to make sodium lauryl sulfate less harsh. The most common way is to combine sodium lauryl sulfate with other surfactants in the one cleanser. And this is really common practice. I don't remember the last time I saw sodium lauryl sulfate in a cleanser by itself. The way this works is, once you mix a cleanser with water, you get lots of individual surfactant molecules floating around by themselves, as well as big clusters called micelles. Now remember, the main thing that makes cleansers irritating is when the individual surfactant molecules can burrow into skin. And sodium lauryl sulfate is very skinny, it's very narrow, which means it's really good at doing this. But it can't do this when it's in a big cluster. The micelle is too big. So it's actually those individual molecules that didn't get into the micelles, floating around by themselves, that can burrow into skin and cause that irritation. So one really good approach to making sodium lauryl sulfate less irritating is to try to get more of them into these micelles. The scientific term for this is to lower the critical micelle concentration. It turns out if you use a bunch of different surfactant molecules to make micelles, these mixed micelles, they actually incorporate more of the SLS into them. And that means less individual molecules that can get into skin and less irritation. Using a mixture of surfactants to do the job also means that you can reduce the concentration of the more irritating surfactants. There are other special technologies as well, like using polymers that stick onto surfactants, again forming a much larger cluster and not letting them get into your skin. Another common practice is to add ingredients that reduce irritation into the cleanser. For example, polymers, emollients, hydrolyzed protein, glycerin, and antioxidants. So just seeing sodium lauryl sulfate on a cleanser ingredient list doesn't mean that cleanser will be irritating. And if you're using a cleanser that you really like, but it happens to have sodium lauryl sulfate in it, that's not a reason to stop using it. But if you're looking for a cleanser and your skin is quite sensitive or prone to dryness and irritation, and there are a few different cleanser options you're looking at, maybe picking the one that doesn't have sodium lauryl sulfate might be a better bet. So that is sodium lauryl sulfate. What about sodium lauryl sulfate? Well, I think sodium lauryl sulfate just got swept along with sodium lauryl sulfate because they sound kind of the same, and the word sulfate is really easy to say. There's an older experiment that tested the irritancy of a range of different surfactants, including surfactants that we still use a lot now. Sodium lauryl sulfate turned out to be the mildest. As well as beating sodium lauryl sulfate, it also beat two other sulfates, TEA lauryl sulfate and ammonium lauryl sulfate, and it beat these ones, and you can sort of see why these didn't really take off in the fear-mongering stakes. Disodium cocoamphetate, I am a trained chemist with a PhD. Disodium cocoamphodiacetate, sodium lauryloamphoacetate, sodium cocomethyltaurate. Do you have to cleanse your skin for a certain amount of time, 30 seconds, 1 minute, 2 minutes? The answer is no, not really. Your skin doesn't have to marinate in cleanser to work, but using a cleanser for a little bit longer might give you better results. Let me explain. So I mentioned that cleansers have surfactants and they arrange themselves into clusters called micelles. When you use a cleanser, what has to happen is the oil and dirt has to make it into the middle of the micelles. So this situation on the left has to rearrange itself into the situation on the right. The oil has to break up into droplets and get suspended into the water by the surfactants. Once you have these emulsion droplets, they can be rinsed away, sort of like the oil is dissolving into the water. So to make them rearrange, you have to shuffle stuff around. The molecules quite like being in the second version, so if you jostle them around enough, they'll naturally rearrange like that. So that's what you're doing when you're rubbing a cleanser on your face. You're jostling everything around and trying to get this oil to break up into these emulsion droplets. You can also use a cleansing brush or a sponge or whatever to make them move. Molecules also wiggle around a lot randomly, so if you just leave it, they'll eventually bump around enough that they'll rearrange into that second version. But if you're adding movement, using your fingers or a cleansing brush or whatever, then you don't have to wait as long. It's like trying to clean an oily plate. You could leave it in soapy water for an hour, or you could scrub it and you'll be done in 10 seconds. So time isn't really the limiting factor, it's moving the molecules around enough that they rearrange into the second version so you can wash them away. Obviously you can't physically rub the cleanser all over your face in half a second, none of us are the Flash, I think. Flash, if you're watching, hi. But if you could, it would be enough. So that's why these recommendations for 30 seconds, 1 minute, 2 minutes can be helpful. It's the same logic as brush your teeth for 2 minutes or clean your house for 15 minutes every day. If you make yourself spend more time doing something, then that indirectly makes you do it more thoroughly, even if there's no magic behind the exact length of time itself. Now, the problem with leaving a cleanser on for too long, so for example, if you leave it on like a mini mask, even though the directions don't say that, is that it can be irritating. Cleansers are designed to be washed off your skin. If you look at the recommendations for ingredient usage by formulators, so how much of an ingredient you should be putting into different products, for potentially irritating ingredients, the amount for a leave-on product is going to be lower than the amount for a wash-off product. And that is because of the different contact time. The longer you leave something on your skin, the more time there is for the ingredients in that product to get into your skin. And for some ingredients, you don't want that. So for example, the surfactants, there are lots of surfactants used in rinse off cleansers that shouldn't be left on skin. So the longer you leave that cleanser on your skin, the more time those surfactants have to burrow into your skin and stay there and cause irritation. Other ingredients with different recommendations for leave on and wash off are things like fragrances, preservatives, essential oils. So the moral of the story is, don't just let a cleanser sit on your skin. For those 30 seconds or 1 minute or 2 minutes, make sure you're moving it around on your skin. Otherwise, there's no extra benefit to leaving it on. Now, there is an exception with cleansers that contain actives, where the instructions actually say to leave them on your skin for a certain amount of time. Then hopefully they did their due diligence, they tested it on lots of people, and they found that most people didn't have issues with that extra irritation, in which case, just follow the instructions. Now, whether or not active ingredients can actually work in a cleanser. Obviously, a cleanser doesn't stay in contact with your skin for as long as a leave-on product, so there's less opportunity for the ingredients to penetrate your skin and get to where they need to be to work. So the challenge is making that ingredient stick to the skin better than it stays in the cleanser, and so when you rinse it off, there's still stuff stuck to your skin. With face cleansers, there are a few active ingredients that can be successfully delivered, so for example, salicylic acid, benzoyl peroxide. If we look at other cleansing products as well, with body washes, they can deliver oily substances really well, like stearic acid, lanolin alcohol, plant oils, and even DHA, which is the active ingredient in self-tan. If we look at shampoos, we have anti-dandruff shampoos that deliver those active ingredients. Purple shampoos can deliver purple hair dye, and 2-in-1 shampoos can deliver conditioning ingredients. So it's definitely possible that cleansers can leave behind enough active ingredients to make a difference to your skin, and they don't all wash down the drain. And I'm sure there's tons of other actives that can be successfully delivered that just haven't been studied yet. The problem is, a lot of the time, you need to have a special delivery system to convince the ingredient to stick to your skin. In general, if it's something more oil-soluble, then it tends to stick to skin better. The problem for us as consumers is that it's really hard to tell if a product has the right delivery system unless the brand actually tells you. And leaving it on your skin for too long can cause all of those problems that we talked about before. So I would still recommend leaving cleansers on your skin for as long as the product says to leave it. Don't leave it on for like 5 minutes and expect to have good results. At that point, you are probably doing more harm than good. In general, I would probably recommend using a leave-on product rather than a cleanser if you really want an active ingredient. It's just a bit more reliable. There's a lot more evidence for leave-on products, and you don't have to worry about how long to leave it on your skin for. But there are definitely some situations where a cleanser with active ingredients might be a better option. If your skin is quite sensitive to a particular ingredient, then using it in a cleanser might be a better choice. You can also apply the leave-on product and just wash it off after 10 minutes or 30 minutes if you're worried about irritation. This has been shown to work quite well for some ingredients like retinoids and benzoyl peroxide. I talked more about this short contact therapy in my video about starting on retinoids. I think it's also a really good idea for benzoyl peroxide. Apart from the irritation, there's also the fact that benzoyl peroxide is a massive pain in the Benzoyl peroxide also bleaches things like pillowcases and clothes and towels. Benzoyl peroxide is also like the ingredient that causes issues with layering. It inactivates a lot of other active ingredients, so if you just wash it off before you apply the rest of your routine, you don't have to worry about it. So those are the most popular cleansing myths I got asked about. I'm sorry if I didn't get to your myth. I will hopefully cover it next time. Like, subscribe, notification bell. You can also check out my blog and follow me on Instagram. I'll see you next time for more nerdery.